So let's just talk about oak in Chablis. And as I was saying before, Chablis has such this complex landscape, and that is before producers' styles come into play. It's truly a singular expression of Chardonnay. The wines are nuanced, and you know I feel that Chablis is something truly singular, something that is unusual, and it is often not very oak influenced. Most Chablis producers are not looking to use oak to really change their wines too much. They want to round out their wines. They want to make them more elegant with some oak. If they use oak, they want to enhance their wines without changing them dramatically. And apologies, I'm just opening up my document here. My turn to have a technical difficulty. Okay, here we go.
But do most producers go through malolactic fermentation?
All producers go through malolactic fermentation. There are some rare moments or rare occasions. You know, some people decided to block malo in 2003. Most people were afraid to because they didn't know what that would do for their stability. Speaking of La Roche, Gregory Viennois has once or twice not allowed full malo in some of his wines, but it's extremely rare. And it's pretty safe to say that 99.99% of Chablis goes through 100% malolactic fermentation.
There's a lot of talk about global warming and what appellations are going to be favored and which are going to be suffered from that. Number one, you got to think that Chablis is going to be favored. Number two, as that changes the character of Chablis, do you think that that is a something that's positive or negative?
There are certainly positive and negative aspects. If you look at Chablis even 20, 30 years ago, maybe 30, 40 years ago, there's the whole idea of, well, it's so hard to get grapes ripe in this part of, you know, northern France. That's not the problem today. Maybe in 2021. It's a really rough year this year. But generally speaking, yeah, that's what a vintage of a lifetime in terms of how difficult it was. Definitely, you don't have to worry about the grapes getting ripe. You're not going to make, you know, verjus in every vintage. So that's positive. Will it change the nature of the best wines? Yeah, it's going to, absolutely. Is it possible that the higher half, that is, of Le Clos will be more interesting than the bottom half? Sure. Is it possible that the more north-facing side of Valmour is going to be more interesting than the south-facing side? Absolutely. Is Preuze, because it's much higher up as a Grand Cru, could it be the better, more aerated, slightly cooler Grand Cru? Definitely. But one of the things that Chablis is certainly saying, and the rest of Burgundy as well, but Chablis is definitely saying, what the French like to call the accident climatique, you know, these climactic accidents. And it's just really different every year. And while you certainly get vintages that resemble each other, you know, 15, 2015, 2016, when you get, you know, warm, hot years, or in 18 and 19, the vintages are still very different. And what's happening during the growing season is very different every year. So there's still a lot to be seen. Certainly Chardonnay is a much more malleable grape when it comes to heat and changes in weather than Pinot Noir is, for example. So Chablis is kind of lucky in that regard, but limestone can be pretty unforgiving. Kimmeridgian limestone can be pretty unforgiving, but lots of things can be done in the vineyard, whether it's different, different rootstocks, different plant material, whether it's how the vines are how they're trained, how long the branches are, when do they cut back the branches from the growing season of the prior year. Lots of things can be done to help try to manage what will happen in the growing season. Of course, you never know what's going to happen during the growing season, so there's that.
The conversation has been, your input has been incredibly insightful, and we really appreciate it, and you're really shining.
Yep.
Well, the information's wonderful. I mean, it's clear that you know intimately all of this information. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Oh, no, my pleasure. I spent a lot of time, a lot of hours talking about it. So my pleasure to share. So back to our oak, again, for all the diversity of the Chablisian vineyards, of course, there are winemakers that make the final wines. And in any Burgundian cellar, the words oak and Chardonnay usually go together. But what I was trying to say previously is that basically oak plays the role of an extra in Chablis, as opposed to a supporting actor, as it tends to more in the Côte d'Or. You really expect that even your village wines in the Côte d'Or are going to have oak that is noticeable. And that's not necessarily, frequently not the case in Chablis. And of course, in some cellars, oak doesn't even get an audition. And as I was saying, most Chablis producers use that oak to round out the crisper edges of Chardonnay, even with a full mallow, especially from higher vineyards, cooler sites, Chablis can really be austere and crisp. Less so now, as we were just talking about with climate change, but it still can be a bit, have some tension. And while that might be something that even 15, 20 years ago, we would have accepted, or maybe certain markets particularly like or don't mind, Chablis is sold all over the world now, and there needs to be more of an allowance for palates everywhere, and not everyone wants something that makes you perk up like you've been, just bitten into a lemon or a lime. And one of the things that I notice all the time, and after I've been in Chablis a couple of days, I almost have to laugh when I hear it, is that when someone says first wine in the lineup comes and it's like, any new oak? Oh, 15%, not much oak, whether it's new or not, 20%, still not too much, maybe a little bit in Chablis. But then they say, it's not to make the wine taste oaky, it's just to round it out. Very, very few winemakers, and honestly, only one that I know of in Chablis say, I like a toasty note. And that's Guinolé, Bretodeau, et Domaine de Malande. Almost no one, even if they like oak enhancement, most producers don't want to taste toastiness. And if they taste it, they're usually fine with that for the first couple of years, expecting that. Generally, new oak is only going on a premier Grand Cru unless you're trying to season the oak by kind of hiding it in the much larger cuvee, like a Chablis, for example. You're usually, you usually want this to be a wine that's not going to be drunk for a few years. And by the time it's settled out in bottle and it's ready to be drunk, that toasty note, nutty note, whatever it is, should have kind of dissipated and should be gone from the wine. And one of the major challenges of Chablis producers is that many feel that the tonnelier, or the people that make the barrels, they don't make barrels for the Chablis, they make barrels for Chardonnay. And that's a very, very distinctly different thing. Most producers, even in the Côte d'Or, want people that are making barrels that are toasted low and slow, low heat for a long time. But Chablis is so transparent and so nuanced that it's really, can really be hard to hide new oak. And I was just talking about, usually you're going to see new oak in a premier or Grand Cru, really more Grand Cru. But I was thinking in writing this article of my conversation with Virginie Moreau this just about a month ago. She's at Moreau Nodet, of course, and she said, I only put new oak in my Chablis, and it's only to season barrels so that she can hide it. It's the only cuvee she has that's big enough so that she can hide the new oak and put conditioned oak onto her higher end wine so that she can round out the Chablis but not give them any sort of oaky notes. And of course, usually it's going to be the higher end wines that can handle that new oak because they're more concentrated, maybe have older vines, but you've got a much much better, much more solidly constructed wine, and of course, a wine that should be hopefully aged to some degree before it's being opened and drunk. And so in terms of size, we talked about size a bit before. The Chablisiens usually use the Burgundian Pièce, which is a 228-liter barrel. And they also traditionally use the Fayette, which is 132 liters. And those aren't used a ton. They're used for little parcels. They are used for leftover juice from larger parcels. They are used for topping up. After you've gone around your tasting and you've poured everything back in and all that wine, whether it's Premier Grand Cru, goes into top up the Chablis, make it a little bit better. And of course, there are some bigger barrels that you see. You see some demi-muids, which are 500, 600 liters. So yeah, at least double this or about double the size of those Burgundian Pièces. And you do see some large foudre as well, so much larger barrels, you know, the ones where, you know, we can all that are the size of Manhattan studios. but you see some of those. Epicard has some, and some other producers have some as well. Obviously, the much larger producers are going to have those because they are the only ones that have the quantities to fill them. Usually, you're going to have some negos that would have something like that. And what's always fascinating to me is that the idiosyncrasy of Chablis is that in order to let their terroir show through, and not the forest of France, the terroir and their grapes, not the forest of France. They're very focused on fermenting in stainless steel. But what most winemakers do when they're using the new oak is that they ferment in oak and they age in oak, because when you ferment in oak, you integrate any new oak taste much better. So it's kind of an odd thing. And that's one of the reasons that so many Chablis producers are so careful with their new oak use as well. They're usually very small portions. It's not often that you hear of, you know, 25-30% new oak, unless it's a really tiny cuvee and there's no other option. It's not really what most people want to do. Most people in Chablis are so concerned about maintaining tension, the energy, the floral notes, the pretty citrusy top notes of Chablis, that they want to ferment in stainless steel, control their fermentation, keep the temperature relatively low, not too low, so that it smells, you know, like Sauvignon Blanc, but they want it to keep it pretty low, maintain those fresh aromas, then they'll ease it into a little bit of new oak to age it so that they can round it out during that malolactic fermentation and aging. So, of course, one of the things to keep in mind is that it's easy to have an oak impression or an impression of richness, which can be easily confounded with oak, based on all sorts of different parameters and style, ripeness levels, and the type of press used, batonnage, which is another very big key in how Chablis is made or not. Very different philosophies on that, all around the area. Timing of sulfur use, old vines, new vines, bottling dates, all of these influence the textures and the styles of the wines. And now you're even seeing, because what winemaker isn't artistic? You're seeing amphora, you're seeing concrete eggs, you're seeing stainless steel eggs, which I saw at Nathalie Gilfèvre. They have a custom-made stainless steel egg because they don't really like the concrete. But everyone is always experimenting, seeing lots of kind of the cigar-shaped barrels and stainless steel, trying to get the lees contact without necessarily the oxygen exchange that you get in a barrel. So there are lots of other things that aren't just oak that can go into the final style of a Chablis that can appear like oak sometimes, or like oak influence. So that's always quite, it's always quite fascinating, especially if you're tasting blind. So let's move on into how people make their wines. And of course, it's going to be in the article. So I'm going to go through this very quickly because we've got a lot of wines to go through, and I know we're running behind already. But the two staunchest, I would say, believers in stainless steel, and one for sure, Guillaume Gicot-Michel of Domaine Louis Michel, from Petit Chablis to Les Clos, zero oak, not a single stay, doesn't want it. I think his entire cellar has only stone in it or stainless steel. He's very anti-oak. He wants crystalline pure Chablis, light color, chiseled, you know, ferociously Chablis style wine. Oh, yes, someone's asking something.
Who's the producer that I'm talking about?
Louis Michel. Domaine Louis Michel.
Louis Michel. So, and since I had to repeat anyway, my question for you, what I found interesting is that in the old days, and granted there was a different ownership involved, but I well remember Christian Moreau telling me that they were very much about the ripeness of the fruit as opposed to oak influence. And that seems to have changed now that they have the new auspices. And I'm wondering if that's just an evolutionary thing, or is it just they felt constrained under the old ownership, which was, you know, obviously Hiram Walker and Allied Lions and all that, or is it just that they've changed their philosophy over time?
Well, I still find Christian's wines quite ripe, and of course he is very focused on the U.S. And the Canadian market. Obviously, his wife is Canadian, and so the wines are made for people who want a little bit more richness. And I find his wines quite opulent. I think that to San Fabian, we'll see how the wines evolve. I think Fabian has a slightly lighter touch, and is quite interested in trying to be a little bit more restrained in the ripeness as well as the richness in the wines. But I think that there's a delicate balance between father, son, as well as the market that they're making the wines
changing
for.
Of the guard. And you know, the ripeness certainly I always found very interesting, particularly in things like, you know, Valmuera through the ages, which I enjoyed with age, but I'm more asking about oak versus no oak, because they were anti-oak in the old days, and I don't know if that was really Christian being that dogmatic or because of other influences, or just that their philosophy has changed over time, or again the passing of the guard to the younger generation and, you know, changing the style, ramping down the ripeness but using a little bit of very subtle oak influence.
Very honestly, I can't speak for, you know, what happened back in the day, but you know, Christian has I think he doesn't mind new oak, and it may have also been, you know, new oak is really expensive, so with other owners involved that might not be something that they wanted to shell out for. But when you go in, yeah, there are plenty of barrels in that cellar there. Okay. And there are certainly other sellers where I think, not many barrels, but they have plenty of barrels there. So I bet there could be several factors in play there. Also, you know, with climate change, the Chablis wines, especially because he has so many Premier and Grand Crus, there's more density and richness. Vines are getting older, and the wines can handle that oak even better in time. So
I may be going a little bit off the reservation, because you've made mention of the fact that, you know, different influences from different size barrels, but obviously there are considerations of the sourcing of the wood and how the wood is treated, steam versus toasted, et cetera. And that may be the more bandwidth than we have here, but I'm intrigued about that as well, because you've spent so much time there. And I think you have an interesting and unique perspective that we'd all benefit from if you feel comfortable to share some thoughts on that as well.
I think that the Chablis producers are very, very cautious. They're very picky, and many of them even buy mostly old barrels. So you know, anytime you buy an old barrel, you need to, speaking of provenance, you need to know where they're from. I think they're very, very cautious, because they, steam is not a great idea, I think, for barrels that are going to be used for Chablis. I think that you need something that has really spent its time outside and aged naturally. And you need something that is toasted low and slow, and then that's done properly. So.
So, and again, you touched on something that I was remiss to not ask about, and that's the used barrels versus new oak. And you did touch upon that in your essay, which is something I've passed out there, but they haven't had a chance to read it yet, but I think that'll be fascinating for all of them. So thank you for that point.
Yep, absolutely, pleasure. So just going again very quickly, because we need to get to our other wines, through some of the other winemakers that I touch on in the article, also staunchly anti-oak is Didier Pic at Domaine Gilbert Pic. His style is just richer. His wines are always much more golden in the glass, but absolutely zero oak in that cellar. He has a much more a richer, more generous fruit character style. The most unusual producer, I guess, of them all is probably Daniel Etienne de Fay, who's Paul Etienne, is taking over as his dad's domain. And those wines don't see oak at all, but they definitely see extensive lees aging with batonnage, all in line fermentation vats, but they're just not released until easily 10 and 13 years after the vintage. The wines that I tasted this year when I was there were 2007, and that's their current release. So they get, you know, unique, ripe, round, creamy wines without any oak use at all. So again, there's a lot of production techniques that go into the making of wine that is very malleable, like Chablis, and nuanced and vulnerable even, just in how you make it. Moving on to other producers, you know, the vast majority of producers in Chablis, especially if they're making some sort of premier Grand Cru, they are using oak in some form or another. And as Francois Servin told me a couple of years ago, he said, I like my wine to at least have some Burgundy in this to them. The producers also, they amend their techniques over time. Some producers just started using oak. Some producers have dialed back the oak. Even in Grand Crus, again, I was just mentioning climate change, age of vines, some people, you lose some vines, they were in métayage or en fermage. You lose and gain different quantities. When you have a smaller quantity of wine, it's harder to include new oak because it's going to be more obvious. So if you have 2021, if you have tiny, tiny yields, you're probably going to use a lot less new oak because there's just nowhere to hide it. And for example, Louis Moreau, we were, I was tasting with him this year, and his wife Anne was teasing him because tasting his Vaudesire Grand Cru, and he's not had oak in that cuvee for quite a while. And he was like, you know, I'm thinking about reintroducing some new oak. And his wife Anne was like, wait a minute, you spend years taking the oak out of that wine. What are you doing? He said, well, you know, the vines are older and we're getting riper vintages, so maybe the wine can handle it. And so it's always a work in progress. There are lots of producers who are not dogmatic and they don't do things systematically. Well, there are producers that are dogmatic, but they don't always do things systematically. So you definitely see some malleability as time goes on, which is, I think, a good thing and a normal thing. And of course, there are those winemakers who never use new oak, and there are quite a number of those. And one we've talked about, Fev, one is Didier Seguier at Fev. William Fev used to use loads of new oak. He was one of the first in Chablis to be like, oak it, make it fancy, show them that we have money. And that was certainly a style, but DVA cut that out pretty quickly. Of course, he's very lucky. He's got a great supplier of oak with the Henriot Group and his sibling winery, the Bouchard Père et Fils in Beaune.
How often you go to Chablis, and when was the first year that you visited?
I go every year, and I'm there for a week to week and a half. The first time I was there was in 2004, then I was back in 2008, in 2010, and then since 2012, I've been there every year for a week to week and a half.
I was just curious. Thank you very much.
Yeah. I was going to talk about a relative newcomer, Patrick Pughes, from Montreal. He only wants old oak. He has probably more barrels than anyone else in Chablis. They are everywhere. But he has a very particular thing. He only uses, when he buys oak, he wants his second use oak or third or fourth use, whatever it is. He wants that first vintage to have been from a cool year. So he might, for example, buy barrels that were first used in 2004 or 2007 or 2010 or 2011. He wants 2017, 2021. Those would be vintages where he'd say, oh, if that barrel was first used, I would use that again, because there's obviously a great interchange between oak and wine, especially in that first vintage. And he wants something that comes from a cool vintage, because he does not want a wine that has been infiltrated with wine from a much warmer vintage. Let's move along again very quickly. We are definitely running out of time here. Anyway, the permutations are endless. There's always a vintage factor to take.
From our standpoint, you have as much point as you need. You were more than patient. So it's more a question of your bandwidth and that of the Zoom meeting. But we're more than happy to take as much time as you'd like at this point.
Okay, thank you. I'll just wrap up here with some very broad generalizations of top producers that I feel are less marked by oak, but this is super, super hard. And then those that are marked a little bit more by oak and fruit ripeness, fruit generosity, super hard because, you know, many producers will make a tight, chiseled, perky Petit Chablis and Chablis, and then, or maybe even Premier Cru, and then their Grand Crus can be quite different. And there's also always the difference of people who own their vineyards and people who buy in as a négoce, or maybe they do an exchange of fruit in Premier or Grand Cru to make something else to add to their lineup. And sometimes somewhat whomever they're buying from is not necessarily farming or harvesting when they would. And that changes their style. But I certainly see that in some of Clotilde Devin's wines. There's so many nuances. It's good to know where everyone's coming from, but it's also almost impossible. But basically, top producers, certainly not a complete list of people, but top producers that I feel have a style less marked by oak would be Jean-Claude Bessin and Bio Simon under the Favelay ownership. Because obviously before, when Samuel Biot was making it, the family was under control of it. It had a much more opulent, much more oxidative style. It was a very, very different style. And so we have a 2008 that we're going to taste, or that you're going to taste, that might be more of that opulent style, even though it's from a cooler vintage. A very good vintage, I should say, as well, for Chablis. But certainly today, Bio Simon is much more dialed in. Domaine d'Henri, which of course is Michel Laroche. He used to be at Domaine Laroche. Juin Vaudan. Which is Joseph Durand at their Chablis property, Eleni et Edouard Vaucoret, Guy Thorand, Jean Collet, Jean-Marc Brocard, his son Julien Brocard, who of course also oversees Jean-Marc's production today, La Chablisienne, the cooperative, fantastic cooperative, Nathalie Gilfèvre, Houdin, Pinson, Samuel Biot, of course on his own now, Sébastien Dante, and Domaine Vigneault, Guillaume Vigneault. And then those that I think have more generosity, which is not always exclusively attributable to oak, but certainly have a more, a richer style, oak ripeness, et cetera. Bernard Defay, Christian Moreau, Daniel Damps, Domaine Laroche, Duplessis, Guy Robin, for sure, Jean-Marc, do I have Jean-Marc Brocard in there? I would take that out. I'll have to amend that article. I have an error there. Jean-Paul et Benoît Trouin. Of course, Benoît is taking care of the domaine now. L'Aventureau, L'Homme de Paquis, of course, owned by Bichot, Domaine Roy, and Sébastien Dant. My little postscript very quickly is just because Chablis is such a singular style, I think it deserves some more attention. We drink it in a way that's typically, you know, apéro, apéritif. We don't listen to it, we quaff it. We drink Chablis quite cold. Generally speaking, it's something to wet one's whistle as opposed to a pièce de résistance. We often just kind of move on before we really allow it to open up in a glass. So I would say watch the serving temperatures, more of a cellar temperature, especially for Premier and Grand Crus, and just allow the wines to really have the time to open up. I was also going to say that so often, because I haven't met you guys, but you're clearly deep into the wine, into the wine culture. I find so often that when we taste Chablis, we're tasting something else after it. And so if you taste kind of unoaked wines and some oak wines, you might taste a Grand Cru Chablis, and it follows by a village, whatever, Chassagne, Meursault, the Meursault village could overshadow a Grand Cru just because it has oak and it has a different density and different texture. So it can be it's quite easy to lose Chablis when you're tasting them in a lineup. Just some food for thought. And with that, we should get back to tasting our other Chablis. And are there any questions before I go on? Because I know I went through that.
Any questions on the first flight of Grand Cru or other questions before we move on to the Le Clos flight? So Christy, I tend to go off script, so please bear with me, but this group loves to vintage. So universal applause here, but so my question is that a number of the folks in the room here love to travel and visit the wineries and get to know the personalities, and I would greatly appreciate, and I'm sure the audience would as well, any thoughts you have on for folks able to travel to Chablis whenever we get back to some version of normalcy in this world, who you would highly recommend and perhaps why to visit. Again, as individual clients as opposed to people in the trade.
Yeah, sure. Why don't I send you a list of suggestions after we wrap up and then perfect. You can pass. Okay, great.
Great, thank you, perfect.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm just going to speak really quickly on the 2014s that I know you have there, and then we'll pass on to the Grand Cru. The 2014s, I mean, I'm deeply jealous. I will 14, not hide that. I'm totally jealous.
The 14.
What a great vintage.
Yeah.
Concentration, weight, balance, purity, precision. It's just, it's really fantastic. And it's one of those vintages to you. The word, it's like, the whites are so fantastic. The reds are very different. Obviously, we're in a different part of Burgundy, but it's worth paying attention to white vintages versus red vintages because they can be so, so different. And 14 is such a spectacular white vintage. But let's talk really quickly about the Fev and the Raveneau Monte de Tonnerre. So the Fev Monte de Tonnerre, I'm going to grab my map again. Because I like this, as you know. we're on the other side of the Serrain, so we were on the left bank here. We're going over to the right bank, but let's see if I can, how well I can do this. So the Monte de Tonnerre is right here. It is the first big hill that's just south of the Grand Cru. Right here. And it has three parts. It has the Côte de Bréchon at the top, and the Côte de Bréchon goes back up into the hills. And then it's got the Pied d'Alou at the very top. And then it has the Chapelet, which is very, very big at the bottom. So three very different expressions of Monte de Tonnerre. And in the William Fev, you have all three bits. So you have a real Monte de Tonnerre, just because you have a little bit of all of it. And the Côte de Bréchon part is actually part of the mother vineyard for William Fev. So it provides the vines for all of their replantations. So it is it's a very prized vineyard at William Fev. It was originally planted in 1936, and it's the oldest plantation of the winery. And overall, because you have a good portion of the Pied d'Alou up at the top and the Côte de Bréchon, which goes up in the valley, so it's much cooler, you've got winds and less sun exposure. It's quite a chiseled expression. And the winemaker Didier Seguier often says it's a Chablis for a Riesling drinker, because it tends to be quite perky. And then with the François Raveneau, Raveneau has a pretty large 3 hectare 10 parcels I should say of Monte de Tonnerre. I believe there are 8 parcels in total, but this is a really interesting cuvée to taste, or I should say a vintage to taste, because the Monte de Tonnerre in 2014 does not have the Chapelot included. So sometimes those of you who are big Raveneau fans, who isn't, will know that they've bottled the Chapelot on the side, and so in 2012, 2013, Chapelot was blended into the Monte de Tonnerre. In 2014, they didn't include it. And the Chapelot are old vines. And so when the wine is really shining, it's only 2.7 hectares, that old bit of Chapelot. So, but when they really shine in really good vintages, they tend to, Isabel tends to make it on its own. And also, this is one of Raveneau's largest cuvées, and it's the one where I often do see a little bit of oak, because they do tend to have some new oak on it, because it is their biggest parcel, their biggest their biggest production wine. Any thoughts on the 14s? If not, we'll go to the Blanchot. All right, let's head to the Blanchot. I particularly love Blanchot, and yes, go ahead, Edward.
No. Everybody is waiting for your ensuing commentary with bated breath, although we have one who's braving it and coming up to speak, who you've heard from before.
Okay.
So this Blancho from La Roche, can you hear me? The Blancho
yep.
from La Roche? Okay, good. So I think that, you know, they have the normal bottling, which is all we're having, but then they also have this L'Obédience or whatever the heck that is. What are they distinguish? These old vines or what is it?
Yeah, it's the best parcels of Blancho. And every single year I've been asked several times, and it's never at a time when I can go. It's usually in May. When Gregory does the blending, but they go through every single parcel, and of course in some years it's not always the same parcels, that usually is, but they go through every single barrel of Les Blancho to make the best possible expression
it is special. But why did they choose Blancho for that?
That's a good question. I don't know.
Could it be that they have old vines there and so there's some diversity with the different age vines there, so that they think that having a best barrels cuvée or non-cuvée would be worthwhile?
Well, they do have a huge piece of it. Blancho, back to the map. So Blancho, of course, is the Grand Cru that's actually very east facing. And so we can see Les Clos here, and Blancho kind of goes up into the valley of Fie. And so they have, up in Fie, you get a huge forest, which you can kind of see this kind of crest here. And there's a big forest, and it's quite cool, just even walking down the road from this main road here up there, you can feel the temperature cool down with all the forest around there. And they have a huge chunk of Blancho, and it goes from the very top of the slope. It's a super, super steep slope. It looks like, you know, the Mosel. It's quite dramatic from the very top of the slope to the very bottom. And so they do have a huge chunk of Blancho because they do own that generous part of it. It could be for that reason that they want to make something that's quite distinctive from it.
And if I may, so that's a selection of best barrels, maybe even, you know, best selection of the grapes, different than, say, Moreau's Clos des Hospices, which is a subsection, wild section within Les Clos. So a different interpretation, but both more rarefied and arguably harder to come by and even more special.
Yes. Yep. I think so. Yep. About the Blancho and going back to oak, since that's one of our focuses, this does see about 90% new oak, so it sees quite a bit of oak. Obviously they have not a lot of new oak, but the vast majority of the cuvée does go into oak. Again, to round it out, because again, this is the coolest of the Grand Cru sites, so you want to kind of take the edge off of something that might be a little bit too vividly tangy otherwise. So you do get a good bit of oak influence, but hopefully we're not tasting a lot of toasty oakiness there. So here again, just like with the first four wines, we've got the 2018 Patrick Pius Blancho Grand Cru. It comes from a very, very different part of Les Clos, Blancho, because it's closer to Les Clos and down towards the bottom of the road. So whereas I don't know if you can see this, but whereas you would get, this is kind of where La Roche is, you're going to get, this is where Pius is. So he's in a warmer portion of it, and he's a little bit further down on the slope as well. He has two parcels so everything, obviously, that Patrick does goes into older oak. So even though this is has one more year on it, you might see even more subtle oak, or you should see much more subtle oak on this wine if you do sense any oak between the two wines, because it's all old oak and it is 1 year older. And also the 2018 vintage is certainly has much more juicy ripeness to it. Of course, Patrick starts he's always one of the first to start, so he harvests very early. And also, there's going to be more bottle age on this than the average 2018 Chablis, because Patrick basically stuffs everything in the bottle extremely early. He puts everything in the bottle before the next harvest. So you can already see the 2020s on the market here in the U.S. Any thoughts on Blanchot before we move into Valmure? Okay. Valmure it is. So now we get to go back a little bit more in time. We're going to talk about 2013 and 2012. We've got Patrick Puse's 2012 Valmure and Christian Moreau's Patrick Puse's 2013 and Christian Moreau's 2012. So 2013 was not an easy vintage. It was kind of difficult. It was a pretty cool year overall. There was an Indian summer, thank goodness. So that dry, warm September really helped to save the vintage. It's very much a winemaker's vintage. And getting the harvest date right is pretty key. Of course, we say that more and more these years because we're either waiting for ripeness, or we're hurrying, trying to keep the ripeness from going overboard. But generally speaking, the 2013 vintage would be, even for Grand Crus, a wine to consume a little bit earlier than, say, even maybe a 2012. But it's certainly in the hands of the best producers. All good winemakers make good wines every year. And in the hands of the best producers, and certainly someone like Patrick should have some good crystalline vibrancy to it, especially during that, because of that cool year. So the vines of Valmure for Patrick are very much up in the top of Valmure. So Valmure touches Les Clos, which is on the other undulation to the north of Les Clos. And so if you can see it right here, this is Valmure. And there are two sides. The side that touches Les Clos is called L'Envers, and the other side is called L'Endroit. Patrick is on the southern side, so his parcels are going to be a little bit cooler. He's very close to Jean-Claude Bessin, Benoît Drouin, Moreau Naudet. They're up in the higher portion of Valmure, so definitely a cooler site. I mean, Patrick says this is always his spiciest wine. It's just there's a spice to it that he wouldn't get out of most of his other wines. Moving on to the 2012. Also a Millésime Juvignol, winemaker's vintage. Also cool and challenging, but definitely a wine that has a little bit more, some would say a little bit more aging potential. Interestingly, this is on the other side. So this is on the northern side, which we get more sun coming into Valmure. And it's really interesting. You just cross the road. If you stand in the middle of July on a sunny day on the southern side, it's still warm, of course. But if you go into the northern side, you're going to get a sunburn in like 5 minutes. It's really quite striking. Also, because even though you're up in this little valley where you've got wind flow coming in, the heat also concentrates there. So you've got wind flow, but you've also got a little bucket of heat up there. The Christian Moreau is almost entirely on the northern side. It's about 80 ar, and he has about one fût from the south side, or one small barrel from the south side. And so you do get a little bit of like a bright, crisp southern side of Valmure going in, but it's mostly from the northern side. So very much like the style of the Christian Moreau wines, definitely a riper style of wine. And there's not a lot of topsoil in these parts. And so Fabien is actually working the vines by horse because he's very concerned about compacting the roots and making the vines even more stressed. All right, shall we move on to the Grand Cru Les Clos? And we have four wines. I think you're tasting them all at the same time.
Yes, all together.
Okay, fantastic. So we've got 2019, 2013, 2008, 2007. It would be fantastic to be able to taste there with you, and to see how the wines are showing. But so I'll just give you a little bit of background on these wines. So Domaine La Roche has about 1 hectare 12, and about 30 R's that have been planted relatively recently and won't go back into the assemblage, into the cuvee for quite a few years. But otherwise, the vines are 45, 50 years old. Already, that's relatively old in the grand scheme of things. In Chablis, they tend to have fewer older vines than other parts of Burgundy. But Domaine Larose, this is 100% oak. Not all of it is new. I do not have the exact percentage of new oak here. But definitely it is all vinified and aged in oak. So the 2013 Patrick Pugh's Les Clos, my suspicion is that this wine is going to go away. So if you haven't heard this, I've got news. Patrick buys this from Vaucouray. Eleni of Italy, Eleni and Edouard Vaucouray told me when I was there that they are most likely going to be buying Edouard's family domain. So I believe it's not going to be into the 2023 vintage, I believe she said. But I suspect that Patrick will not be making Les Clos, at least not from this fruit, in the next, maybe he may have one more vintage left. But I don't know if he has a contract or if it's a handshake or if it's year to year, but Patrick is very wild. He'll find more like clothes. So don't worry, it'll still be out there. But there are two plots and this should be reverting to Eleni and Edouard. And of course, this is all going to be fermented in all old oak barrels by Patrick. So as I mentioned before, moving to our older vintages, the 2008. Chablis, fantastic vintage in 2008. High sugar, high acidity, certainly age-worthy wines. I really hope this one is showing well. This wine would have been made by Samuel Billot. And of course, this was when the family owned the domain and before Favelet bought it. Again, as I mentioned before, the wines are quite different, much more of an oxidized, kind of, I would say cheesy, like a cheese rindy kind of style. Even when the wines were young, they tend to be much darker in color, even earlier on. And they tend to be kind of just more more mouth filling. I don't want to say rich as in sugar rich, but just bigger and more powerful because there was a lot more oxygen exchange with the wine. Definitely not Samuel style, which is part of the whole changeover with the family domain and selling things. But that is generally what I would set myself up to think about with regard to these wines. And such an interesting contrast to look at 2007 from Favelet, who of course would end up buying Bio Simone. 2007, certainly being a much leaner, crisper year, which, you know, might be a bit austere early on. And I'd be quite interested to hear how it's showing right now. I'm very curious.
So we're getting one opinion that there's some oxidization, a little bit of herbal notes to it, but it's nice. It's just, it's delicious, but following the La Roche and the Puise, especially those two, they perhaps suffer a little bit in comparison. All very interesting, but the first two are the, I think the consensus is the most compelling.
Very cool. I said, well, are there any questions? Hopefully next year, you know, we're out of this crazy bubble that we've been in for the last, almost 2 years now. And perhaps we can taste some Chablis together. But I would love to either field any questions before heading off and finding my own glass of Chablis. just any, happy to hear any other comments.
Oh, any questions for Christy before she very belatedly gets to drink some Chablis herself? So there was one question very intrigued about your experience in the wine trade and becoming one of the first MWs in the United States. And then separate from that, I'm going to ask you to, I hate to use the term circle back, but for those that hopefully have the opportunity to visit Chablis at some point in the future when things get back to some version of normalcy, estates or places or even restaurants in the near area that you would recommend from your experience there?
Yep, sure. I'll start with the last bit first. For probably 7 or 8 years, there has been a fantastic restaurant in Chablis called Au Fil du Zinc, which is absolutely tremendous. It is worthy of Michelin star, certainly Bib Gourmand, all that. It is right on the River Serein. The Serein actually runs underneath it. It's very charming. It has always been kind of a price fix sort of thing. I think we had 8 or 9 courses this last time when I was there. It's really gastronomic in experience, very classy, and has a very approachable wine list. You know, you can drink, you know, back into the 80s for easily under 100 euro. It's really an exceptional place. Definitely reserve in advance. There is also kind of its sister restaurant, Les Trois Bourgeons, which is, both of these restaurants were established by Japanese chefs, and so there's very, very much a precision to the style of cuisine, but Les Trois Bourgeons is a bit more casual, does lunch and dinner, very, certainly an approachable wine list, but, you know, not an 8-course tasting menu, sort of an experience, but great for lunch and, you know, or a quick dinner sometime. Just across the street from Les Trois Bourgeons is Daniel Etienne Buffet's Le Machin Vigneron, which is really fantastic. Daniel Etienne is just, he's a huge personality, massive smile. The wines are all his, understandably, but you can drink lots of older wines, which is super cool always. He also has some other reds and some champagnes on his wine list as well. The food is quite rich, but it is absolutely delicious. It's very Burgundian. You know, don't look for vegetables there. You will eat very well. So that's fantastic. And then the newest is Chablis Why Not, which is from Fabienne, who used to be at Au Fil du Zinc. You walk in and you look like you could be in Tribeca in New York City, or, you know, some downtown Chicago. It is very sophisticated. You really need to order wine by the bottle because their wine by the glass list is quite tiny, but lots of things off the, like, off La Plancha, very lots of grilled stuff, very casual, more of a kind of a tapas sort of menu, but great wine list and a place to just even go back and go and knock back a couple of glasses of wine. So that's just in Chablis. There are some fantastic restaurants also in the areas, but you have to drive. And if you're staying in Chablis, it's not fun to drive after you've been drinking, obviously, and Uber and Lyft don't exist in Chablis. But I have some good numbers for taxis for you. Still not as easy to get to some of the other great restaurants around. But of course, if you were ever in Irancy, this sweet little town of Irancy, you have to go to Eau Soufflot, which is fantastic. And Eau Soufflot also just took over what used to be the, what was it called? The, it was like the bistro, I think it was called Bistro de Grand Cru, which was in the building where William Febb's tasting counter is, and Les Mots Fous is now there, and they have a nice little terrace in the back if the weather's good, and that is a fantastic place to eat.
Thank you. Can so we impose on you to send a synopsis of that via email, and I'll share it with all the attendees?
Sure, no problem.
Perfect, thank you.
Okay. Yep, and then, gosh, you know, as far as becoming a master wine, and that was quite a long, arduous experience, very much worth it, but really interesting challenge, because it's not just about learning how to taste wines blind, which most people think that the experience is. That's a tiny portion of it, even though we taste a lot more wines blind than the master sommeliers do. They only taste 5, we taste 36.
Jim, are you listening to that? The MW versus the MS thing?
But it's also about, you really have to understand all about the trade of wine, vinification, viticulture, stabilization of wine, international shipping of wine, the business of wine, current events in wine, and of course you have to write a 10,000 plus word dissertation or a research paper to give back to the wine community that's been supporting you the entire time, helping you pass. It's quite an endeavor, but well worth it.
So I had a friend who equated it to getting an MBA and a doctorate in any other discipline.
Yep, I agree. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much. And again, my personal apologies, and thank you for your patience. number of people in the room today have always been big fans of Chablis, but I think they have a whole new level of appreciation. So thank you so much. And I would also be remiss if I didn't add that Christy's CV is available on our website if you want to get a little bit more information on her background and some of the things she's done within the wine trade.
Thank you for that. And I hope you can see my passion for Chablis is pretty endless. So it's really kind of passed over. It's a stunningly beautiful region. The wines are super nuanced. They just need a little bit of little listening to and TLC, just kind of trying to understand them. And that can really open up a whole new vision of Burgundy and Chardonnay. It's just a completely different beast of Chardonnay, which I love.
This was a very interesting confluence of comparing and contrasting the different vineyard sites, the producer philosophies and vintages as well. So I'm very pleased with the selection that we came up with. And
it was great. Kudos to you and your group. Fantastic group of wines.
So the last thing I'm going to put you on the spot about is, as Jeffrey, who's the one who keeps coming up and taking the microphone and asks the passionate questions, knows, I've historically been a huge Auspice de Beaune fan. And I've not revealed to any of the attendees what we're contemplating with regard to your commentary and participation for us on Auspice de Beaune coming up, assuming all the planets align. So I'll leave it to you on that one.
Sure. Yep. So as many of you probably know, Sotheby's took over the Auspice de Beaune this year, which is quite a coup.
After being a Christie's guy, I can say yes.
but leave it to Jamie Ritchie. He's quite the mastermind, and such a charismatic businessman as well. But as I'm usually into, I should normally actually be in Burgundy just about now. The trip has been delayed by about 2 weeks, but he has invited me to come and taste in advance the Auspice de Beaune auction, and then to write up my notes. So hopefully this will all come to play as I'm trying to finalize some points of my trip. And if so, I'm going to be looking forward to writing up my notes for you in advance of the auction.
So stay tuned, but the expectation and the hope is to add that insight and commentary to our ongoing educational content on wine auction prices. So Christy, thank you so much for the tremendous insights and for your infinite patience while we tried to, you know, climb the hill of IT interaction here.
We've all been doing it, so I completely understand. I think
I have a whole new appreciation for Facebook being down for the better part of a day.
I think we all appreciate that.
Anyway,
enjoy the wines and I know you've got some Chateauneuf coming up, so have a great evening and take care. See you all soon, I hope.
I'm reminded, tough act to follow. Thank you so much.
Cheers. Take care. Good luck. Courage. Bye.